Standing on the corner, like an angel in disguise. She's got dangerous eyes.
Tells me she's a model, offended at her reputation. Sliding in a bottle, with a simulation.
She's so indecipherable, she holds the key to the missing core. Just the thought of her touch, my mind explodes. So desirable. The time never will unfold. The riddle of the muddle.
Welcome to the Two Tone Podcast. My name is Jaylor Kell. Alongside me, as always, we got
Theo Kell.
How you doing, kid? How you be?
I'm doing good.
If you're unfamiliar with the song that we're gonna get a strike against on YouTube that we just used, if you're unfamiliar with the song, it's from the album of the week and the film of the week. We chose an album and a film that it's the soundtrack of the movie that I chose, but we'll get into that later. So here on the Two Tone Podcast, I just want to tell y'all thank you for subscribing. If you're not subscribed, please hit that subscribe button. It's a free way to show us that you appreciate what we're doing, you know. And yeah, what you been up to, T? What you been up to recently?
Working.
I'm going to say creative-wise or just, you know, just your day-to-day.
A little bit of both.
You still working the kinks out on Channel 6?
Yeah.
You still in the...
It's going to be like next year when this comes out, but yeah.
I'm going to say sometimes it just takes time. And, you know... You ain't even necessarily got to go with that one, you know, as the next one that you dive into, you know, head first. But you can always kind of put it on the back burner and work on something new, you know. Sometimes I feel like working on something new in my experience can help relieve the pressure of feeling like you need to finish it to 100%, you know.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with working on something else for a little while, you know. Save your mental state trying to just burn out on one thing, you know?
I think it's my brain. It's so used to working on one thing at a time that it's kind of hard to
jump ship
to a whole different type of film, but...
I totally get what you're saying. But, you know, every now and again, it's healthy to work on something new, you know? But... Again, just want to say thank you. Everybody is watching the Two Tone Podcast. We appreciate y'all. Share it with your friends. But yeah, let's get on into it. Welcome back to the Two Tone Podcast. We probably should get into the film of the week and whatnot, just straight off the rips, since we used that song in the beginning. Many of people might not know what it's from. You want to tell them what it's from, or you want me to tell them what it's from, T?
It's from Sing Street, the movie.
Ram-pa-pa-pa-pum. So TT chose Sing Street, and I was like, oh, that's such a good fucking movie, man. Such a good soundtrack, too. And I was like, well, make my job easy. Just pick the soundtrack from the movie you picked. But if you haven't seen Sing Street, it's about this kid and his family is like going through a rough time, you know, not making as much money. And he has to go to this different school called Sing Street. And,
spelled differently from the title, though.
Right. It's like it's got a Y in there. I forget exactly how it's spelled, but. He ends up getting bullied and, you know, there's this girl across the street from the school and he's like, oh, what's her name? You know, she's so beautiful. I just have to know her, you know, da da da. And he ends up coming up, walking up to her and being like, oh, I'm in this band, you know. And there's absolutely no band when he tells her that he's in this band and he's trying to recruit her for a music video. And he like makes a band within like these 3 days and then gets her this demo track for the song that they're doing. And the song is like about her, but he's just trying to play it off as like, oh, it's not about you. It's about this other model chick that I'm friends with. And she's like, oh, is it really now? And yeah, it's just kind of like a romantic, you know, will they get together, won't they, kind of movie. But the score of the movie is so fucking good. It's like a very 70s, 80s influenced. There's a Rio, I forget who sings it. But it's like a mix of like original songs from the movie and just music that was popular at the time. You know, MTV had just started, and that's a really big influence on why the main character wants to make music videos. And, you know, but enough with the synopsis. What made you choose Sing Street? What was the determining factor for choosing Sing Street this week?
I'm gonna have to give it to Kyle again. It was another film that he suggested, but I already watched it before. Before he suggested it, I already watched it, and I totally forgot about it till he sent it to me. But yeah.
But I wouldn't doubt that it's that Kyle had suggested it to you. I believe me and Kyle had seen it like around when it came out, and it was one of those movies that I was like, damn, we really could do this. We could start a band, you know? And I would definitely say that movie was kind of influential on me and Kyle's early band experiences, me, Kyle, and Curtis. But yeah, it's just like, it's this movie about the just finding friends around school that play instruments and stuff and coming together to make a band. And I found it really interesting because it really is kind of that easy when you're in school, you know, just put up a flyer and somebody's like, oh shit, I play piano or whatever, you know. And then slowly but surely you got a band. That's really how me and Kyle started, you know.
Yeah.
But from like a cinematic viewpoint, is there anything in Sing Street, not necessarily in a cinematic, but like in a adventuring into the cinematic universe, you know, what kind of influence does it have on you seeing that he's trying to make music videos and, you know, recording and editing and stuff like in the early days of music videos?
Well, it kind of makes me feel like a lot of people, anybody could really get into making film and stuff, because it like shows, it's just, it might be a little bit more difficult than most people think it is starting out, but with enough passion, you could do it, definitely.
I'm about to say, most definitely, it's like the main character, he literally doesn't have a band, doesn't have any recording video or audio experience before.
Yeah.
Before he, you know, tries to spit game at the girl across the street. But it is, it does kind of show you that it really is that easy, you know. You just got to go out and do it, and then eventually you'll get better, you know. The character in the movie, the main character's older brother, I feel like he's also a very integral character to the storyline, you know, in the beginning. You know, he's not afraid to tell his little brother that it's shit, you know, and he's not saying it in like a harmful way, you know. He's like, there's this part in the movie where the little brother is like, So you think it's and then the older brother cuts in and he goes, shit. Yeah. But it's got potential. We can get there, you know. He's not dogging on him, just a dog on him, you know. He's trying to, you know, tell him that it's not the best, but the concept is there, you know. As long as you think it will happen, you know, type shit.
I kind of feel like that's kind of what the relationship like is, or what the relationship is with me, you and Kyle and Luke.
Cause, like, I can definitely see that, yeah.
You and, like, I feel like you would definitely, like, help Luke. I feel like you would definitely help Luke.
Oh, yeah, I'm about to say, and, like, if you ever...
if he needed it or anything. And then Kyle's, like, is helping me, and, like, he's telling me all this, like, stuff that he's learned from film school and all this stuff and being in the film industry for how, for forever.
Oh yeah, it's definitely, yeah, it's definitely you help where you can, you know. Like the older brother in the story, he was in the movie, he was a musician himself, you know. He used to play guitar, and then you know, life happened and he dropped out of school and then just kind of lost focus of what he really wanted to do, you know. Just had to get a job, had to start providing. And he sees his little brother just trying to get into music, and he's like, holy shit, like, this could be my way to fulfill my my dream of being a musician and, you know, traveling the world and making music videos and stuff like that. But it's one of those lessons that's, like, even, like, some of the, I don't know exactly how I'm trying to word this. It's a saying I'm trying to think of.
Inspiring.
No, it's like, it's something to do with coaches and like, I forget exactly how the quote goes. It's gonna fucking bug the shit out of me.
It's a quote. I thought you were taking a word.
Jesus Christ, it's gonna bug the shit out of me. Anyways, but it's kind of like how, you know, even though they weren't the best players, they can be extraordinarily good coaches, you know.
Yeah.
In the movie, the older brother, you know, didn't quite have the mindset to become a musician fully, you know. So he just kind of coached his little brother into success and, you know, stardom, as it were, in the show. But it definitely kind of shows you that even if you can't attain exactly what you thought you could, you know, you can kind of find a sense of fulfillment through helping others succeed in the field that you have experience in, you know.
Definitely. It also kind of inspires me to make like a love story film, because I want to make one, but I don't think my brain personally can make one because I'm more into horror and stuff.
I can see where it would seem a little difficult to make a love story, even though you're more versed in the horror genre. Yeah. But you got to spread them wings, baby bird. You know, it ain't never gonna hurt nobody to try and write something. You ain't even gotta bring it to fruition. But, you know, just exercise the entirety of your brain instead of that one avenue, you know.
Yeah.
A jack of all trades, but a master of none, you know, type shit. At least that's what I strive for in my creative ventures, you know. I play piano, I play guitar, play a little bit of drums, you know. I know how to record, mix, all that shit, you know. But I can see where having a specific genre that you're more comfortable with would lend to making more meaningful projects. Speaking of projects, with Channel 6, what was I gonna say? Oh, Jesus Christ. So you said you're almost done writing it, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. So, Channel 6 is changing very much so far. And, I'm not changing the plot necessarily, but I am changing a lot of the scenes into something different than what I originally planned.
Sorry there, for my microphone went out for a second. Still having technical problems, but we were talking about Channel 6. You were kind of changing the, not necessarily like the story as you were saying, but just kind of making the scenes happen in a different way.
Yeah.
So in the beginning, when you were first writing it, how would you say, so the scenes that you're kind of reworking, are you making them more psychological, more like thriller kind of, or, you know, blood and gore kind of shit? What are you switching up? What are you trying to aim for with the revisions?
Just something that's more interesting and not just like scenes of the character walking through a forest by himself for half an hour. Because that's what I originally wrote, but I changed a lot of that to like have action in it, or like something for the character to
just kind of trying to keep up the pace of the movie, just so it doesn't seem like it drags towards the middle of it.
Yeah.
Okay, I can understand that.
I feel like that's what I am having a lot of difficulty on learning, is pacing a film, because I don't want it to be like, oh, well, here's a love scene, so let me just not listen or pay attention to it. And then once action picks up, let me go back to it. Like, I feel like there's a lot of people out there that don't really care about like the love scenes or the conversation scenes. They more care about like the action and like what's going on and how that plays into the story and stuff.
Yeah, I can totally understand that. I'm about to say Arthur, our oldest brother, whenever he would watch like anime and stuff, he would just watch the fight scenes and skip all the dialogue in the middle. And I'm like, what the fuck? You're missing half of the show, dog. What are you talking about? But he's like, oh, it doesn't matter. And I'm like, I think it might in the end, but I don't really understand.
I think it has to do with
too much.
I think it kind of has to do with like me having, well, I'm not diagnosed, but self-diagnosed. Pretty sure I have ADHD. But anyways, I feel like it has to do a little bit with that, because with having ADHD, you're more into like action and like a fast-paced type of film than,
yeah, I totally get that.
Like sitting there for 3 minutes watching somebody talk about how their life sucks and stuff. But I think that just has to do with a little bit of my ADHD.
I can totally understand that. But back to Channel 6. So with the, from what I remember reading, and it's the part you're changing, right?
Yeah.
The scene where like he picks something up off the ground and then he's like in a different reality.
No, that I already got that one down. I think, are you thinking of the scene where he's the one that I'm working on now is the scene where he walks into the auditorium and he sees people standing on the stage.
Oh, the one towards the end that you hadn't quite finished yet? Yes, okay. I'm about to say I just kind of skimmed through it the last time you had showed me to it because we was at work, but
yeah.
But yeah, I can kind of see where that would be a spot that just kind of like slows down for a second, but I think you might kind of want that, you know, just kind of get more into the depth of what's happening and why he's there, you know. But I can understand why it would be a little tricky to kind of figure out how to make it fast enough that it doesn't seem boring, but
slow enough to where you can put more detail into
it. Right, right. To where the story just kind of makes a little bit more sense, you know?
Yeah.
But if you're interested in acting in one of TT's short films or being a stagehand or camera operator, microphone holder, snack supplier, hit him up at Glasshouse Films 8 on Instagram, right?
Yep.
Hit him up. Let's get on into some of the topics that we have for discussion on the Two Tone Podcast.
Before we get into any of those ones, I have another one that we could talk about. Mental health in the art industry.
What about mental health in the art industry?
So,
it's not too good.
Do you think the average artist has more mental problems than, say, the average Joe?
I wouldn't say that they have more than the average Joe, honestly. I can't really speak for people that aren't in the creative industry, but I wouldn't necessarily say that.
Or how do you think the mental health affects people in the art industry?
I definitely think that being an artist and being around other artists definitely has a, I don't want to say kind of like a competition mentality, but, you know, you are competing against everybody else in the industry, essentially, you know. You can become friends with other people and you can become, you know, beneficiaries of somebody else's work through, you know, working with them and whatnot. But I feel like a lot of the times there is that, you know, comparison between, you know, somebody who's up and coming in, you know, say film industry, and somebody that's, you know, kind of established in their area. But I would say there's definitely more emotion in the art.
In the art industry. Jalen's phone's microphone's fucking up right now, so that's why you can't really hear him. Having technical difficulties here.
Okay, I'm back. But as I was saying, there's definitely more emotion in the art industry, but that's, you know, kind of a given because they're artists and art is an expression of emotion. But I wouldn't say that art and mental health problems are correlated in any way, but it is interesting to see how how mental health plays out in the art community. I feel like a lot of times directors and directors and sometimes even actors almost get praised for their mental health problems. You know, I don't know. There's not really a good way to say this, but you know, there's been directors throughout history that have, you know, had like heavy substance abuse and
like Johnny Depp and
what's his nuts that wrote Cujo and fucking Stephen King. Right.
I don't know if he wrote Cujo, but
I don't remember. Either way.
Yeah, I get what you're saying.
I'm not giving you accurate facts, but there's multitude of people throughout the film industry that have heavy substance abuse issues and stuff, and, you know.
But like, even, I feel like that's, like, in any art form, like music, too.
Oh, most definitely,
I feel like
a
lot of people praise people for doing drugs in the music industry and stuff.
Oh, yeah, or most definitely.
Having some type of mental disability or something.
I'm about to say, there's no shortage of musicians that get, they get too much clout for their drug use and stuff, you know, like Juice WRLD and, you know, just most of it comes from like the rap community and stuff. And, but I feel like a lot of substance abuse and stuff like that comes from mental health issues and stuff.
Yeah.
And, so I wouldn't say that it's, they're necessarily correlated, but if somebody is successful and, you know, happens to have a substance abuse issue, 9 times out of 10, it's from some mental trauma that they've endured in their life that they have this substance abuse issue. And, you know, it's just going to get portrayed more in the media because they're popular.
I kind of feel like trauma and mental issues is something that comes along with being in the art business, because, like, you get, like, so depressed and all this stuff because you feel like nobody's caring, and then you'll blow up and become famous, and people will be like, oh, he takes drugs and blah, 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 or he went through so much, blah, 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 and all this stuff. What you looking for?
The power cord.
For? Oh, I don't know. Behind you?
Question mark? I don't think so. Anyways, continue with what you're saying. Sorry.
But yeah, I feel like it comes along with the, like, getting into the industry is a lot of mental health trauma and drug issues and stuff, because, like, depression is a big one, because people will feel like they're not getting any playtime, or, like, any, like, they don't feel like people care about them. So they'll just start being like, damn, this fucking sucks. Why did I choose this as my career choice? Blah, 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 and all this stuff. And then once they make it big, like, they'll drop one song and then they'll become huge, or they'll drop one film and it'll become huge, or something like that. And the people will be, and then they'll be like, damn, a lot of people care, but then at the same time, do they actually? Type stuff.
I can totally understand, like, the ups and downs of being a creator, how it could cause some trauma in a way if, you know, like, you become really popular and then you just kind of fall off. Oh, you're like, damn, like, I had it all type shit, you know?
Or, like, even when you're starting out, like, I can't tell, well, you've been there, but I can't tell them how many times I've had, like, mental breakdowns at work because I feel like nobody fucking cares.
Oh, yeah, I'm about to say, it's not even exclusive to just the creative world, like, you know.
Yeah, but I feel like it comes more in the creative world because you're trying to be something, or you're trying to make something of your life, but then you feel like people don't really care about that.
I can totally understand that.
Or you're, like, trying to make something that people... Like, you're trying to make something to make other people happy, but you feel like nobody wants to bother with what you did. And so...
I can understand the frustration of, you know, just putting all your time and all your energy into something, and then, you know, you get 14 views on it, and you're like, damn,
yeah,
was it even worth it type shit. But in the end, you got to do art because you love to do art, you know? You got to do something because you love to do it. And if you don't really love to do it, then... Don't waste your time, you know. There ain't no reason to try and get good at something that you're not really, like, striving to work for, you know.
Definitely.
At the end of the day, if I lost everything, I'd still probably try and make music eventually, you know. Like, get back on my feet type shit, and then it would still be a part of, like, who I am as a person, you know. It's not something that, even though it would be super nice if, you know, I could, you know, bust onto the scene and then, you know, make hundreds of thousands of dollars and live off of making music exclusively, you know. It's one of those things that I would do it regardless of the circumstance, you know.
Yeah, I understand that.
This is a depressing ass note to leave off on, but my battery is going to die, so we'll be right back for part 2.
It's 2 o'clock on the edge of the morning. She's running magical circles around my head. I hit you right on a dream. She's driving. She turns to kiss me. I crash back into bed. We cross the street on a grayed out Monday. I see the girl with the eyes I can't describe. And suddenly it's a perfect Sunday. Everything is more real than life. think I'm back in the tree.
I don't even know the words.
I think I'm back on the ceiling. It's such a beautiful feeling. Going up. She lights me up.
You just gonna cut me up. Oh, fuck it up, T.
Me up.
Oh, I'm fucking dead.
He said, me up.
Okay. Right. We're back. We're back. Welcome back to the Two-Tone. I can't even fucking do it. Welcome back to the Two-Tone Podcast. I had to get some snacks and fix my audio situation here. So, you know, made TT bitch ass hold his microphone. Made him hold his microphone and give me the boom. But yeah, hopefully the microphone doesn't go out anytime soon. Y'all see how bougie we are with the TV now? We got, you know, just in case you forgot what podcast you're watching halfway through. And we got art and shit. Bro, we coming up. If y'all could see this room behind the cameras, you would be like, what the fuck is this bum ass production value? We got the camera sitting on two milk crates. TT using the table as a footstool, bro. It's all sorts of wildness up here. Anyways, back to the Two-Tone Podcast. Where were we at?
We just got done talking about mental health. And
oh, yes. Okay. Industry. Okay. Before we got into the topics of the week, I don't know if y'all can read that. Probably not. Probably a good thing. Begin Again. So the director of the movie, the director of Sing Street, Kyle. Yep, it's that one. And oh shit, I'm trying to show y'all all my photos. but the director of Sing Street has also made this movie called Begin Again with Mark Ruffalo and that other chick that Kyle is yelling at the screen right now. Yep, it's that one. it's a movie about Mark Ruffalo plays this engineer or something, I believe, you know, he was in a band or making music or at some aspect, you know, and, he kind of loses it all. And then he meets, this chick and he's, you know, he's trying to become her producer or engineer or whatever the fuck he does. I forget exactly, but it's about the Mark Ruffalo character helping the other chick become a musician. It's kind of similar to Sing Street in a way, you know. It was interesting. I didn't know that he had made both of those movies, but I've seen both of them. Very good. There's this one like little date thing that they have where Mark Ruffalo has his iPod and then he's got this audio splitter. It's a audio jack and then you can plug two different pair of headphones in it. So I don't know. They're both walking around town with both of their headphones in, you know, just experiencing the city with the music that he planned out. You know, it's a cute little gay idea for a date, but what you over here you waving at me for?
But what's that film that you were telling me about a while ago?
You just say we lost all our subscribers?
We lost all the gay ones because you said gay.
I mean, gay and like... All right, when I it's like it's a bit between me and Sam, you know. They'll show me something cute, or you know, I'd be like, "Oh, that's gay," and they're like, "What do you mean?" But, anyways, I don't give a fuck. Continue. What was you saying? What was the movie I was telling you about?
This was a while ago. You were telling me about a movie with this dude with the papier-mâché head, and he's like singing.
Oh my god!
And you were telling me about this one song that's about a carpet. Tuft and it's like Tufty or whatever the fuck it's
called. I know exactly what you're talking about. It's called Frank
Tuft,
and the song you're thinking about is called Lone Standing Tuft. So Frank is this movie about this dude. He's got this papier-mâché head, right? And he makes music, and like there's this main character guy. He's not Frank, but you know, Frank's like main character part two.
This was the song I was thinking about.
Hit him with it real quick, you know. We gonna get so many hits on this video. So many strikes to get in it. Alright, that's enough. We got it. Alright. Just in case y'all want some ASMR in the middle of your day.
Yeah.
All right, that's all I'm doing because that shit hurt my soul to do.
That shit hurt my soul to do.
But Frank is about it's about this guy who joins Frank's band, and Frank is this guy that wears a paper mache head. I won't give away the ending, but you know, the dude joins the band and it's like a really futuristic kind of sounding band, and it's just about like really how eccentric Frank is, and
so is it like Sing Street? Just instead of a love story, it's about a dude named Frank.
I wouldn't necessarily say that they are similar in any facet, but they are both like music movies based around a music group.
I also don't think you get strikes on YouTube unless you play like 15 seconds.
Bro, we started the podcast with like a minute and a half. What do you mean? I was sitting here bopping, and then we came back and I was about to say, I was hoping to God we was recording. We are. but anyways, I don't give a fuck. We ain't making no money off of this bitch. We're here for y'all enjoyment. Hit that subscribe button, please. Thank you. Turn the notifications on. Share, copy, link, paste. Do all that shit.
Backflip.
Yep. Just go to the Apple.
If you're watching, you'd get that. But I don't know.
Go to the Apple Store and
download our new game.
Download our new game. If you use code 2tone at betterhelp.com. No, I'm playing. but, you know, go to the Apple Store, subscribe to the channel on all the display iPhones and whatnot. But I forget what the fuck was we talking about.
Frank.
But yeah, I wouldn't say it's similar to Sing Street, like story-wise, but it is definitely a movie about the chemistry between a music group, you know? Sing Street is more like the chemistry between the lead singer of the group that happens to become, and like the lead singer and the girl, Fiona or Winona or some bullshit, I forget what her name is exactly. But Frank is more about the connection between everybody in the group, you know? At one point, there's this chick that plays the theremin. You know what a theremin is?
No.
All right, you ever seen those things? It's like a oval.
Oh, shit, it's on Amazon Prime for free.
It's like an oval pad, and it's got the stick up. It's like a big metal rod, and it's like...
Oh,
you
yeah,
play it with
yeah,
your hands and shit. Yeah. Like with spatial distance around it.
I didn't know what it was called, but yeah. I know
yeah, it's a theremin. And there's a chick that plays that, and she plays that in the keys or some shit. And, you know, she ends up, like, leaving the group, spoiler earlier. And then she comes back eventually. But
do they all have paper mache heads?
No, it's just Frank that has it. And Frank is, like, the lead singer of the group. And it's just basically, like, this kind of, like, normal guy that's just been going around the music scene, just trying to find a band that he fits into, and then he stumbles upon Frank's band and is just slowly learning about like how Frank writes music and like how to become part of Frank's band and stuff. Frank is like this really, really eccentric kind of character, you know, as you were saying, like there's this one point in the movie where everybody's got writer's block and Frank just comes in and he's like, you can write a song about anything. This tuft right here.
Why do you sound like the fucking...
A hoe warrior.
Yeah. Why do you sound like that guy from Sausage Party? The Indian dude? Or the Native American?
Hey, yo, warrior.
Yeah.
Anyways. But Frank talks kind of weird like that. But anyway, if you haven't seen Frank, double film of the week. Hit up Frank.
I need to check it out.
It's super good. Super good. I think you'd like it a lot. It's another one of those movies that, like, it definitely had an impact on, like, my music-making career. I won't even want to say career, you know.
So would you say, like, Frank and Sing Street and all that is, like, what it's kind of like to start in the music industry? Like, just throwing shit together, trying to...
I would definitely say Sing Street is a very accurate representation of it. you know,
like how Brigsby Bear is for the film industry. And
yeah, yeah, is it
together?
It just kind of shows you that, like, if you really have the determination. Wow, I got ahead of myself. If you have the determination and the will to, you know, just make that your everyday grind, that it can become a reality, you know. And also, it kind of shows you that, like, it does take time to make something worthwhile, you know. Like the movie that they made at the end of Brigsby Bear was, like, by no means a blockbuster good movie, but, you know, it was good for what it was.
Yeah.
You also just got to kind of think, you know, in the beginning, you're not gonna be able to pump out something extraordinary, but with time and dedication, anything is possible, young grasshopper.
When you said little bird earlier, it made me think of just like a baby bird sitting in the tree.
Little bird, when I say that?
You said you need to spread your wings, little bird.
Oh, my dumb ass, I literally just said that.
It makes me think of
I gotta go home. What are you gonna say?
Makes me think of like a baby bird that's in a tree nest, and then like the older bird is like flying outside of the nest, and the little bird's like questioning if he should jump or not. That's what it made me think of.
Think to jump. All right, let's finally get into the topics of this week.
Okay.
I'll give you a couple. Let's see what you want to talk about. The writer's strike and the actor's guild. You want to talk about AI? You want to talk about music video?
Let's do AI and... didn't we already talk about music videos?
Kind of a little bit, you know, talking about Sing Street and making music videos and stuff. But I think we could talk about, like, have you ever thought about making a music video, you know? You ever,
Like I told you, Jalen, I'd be down to make a music video. You just need to pick the song.
Well, I know, but I mean, like, have you ever, like... Would that be something that you would be excited to like pursue as a career, you know, like how like Lyrical Lemonade with Cole Bennett, you know how he makes music videos?
Yeah.
Would that be something within the film industry that you would be interested in doing, or would you more want to be a director, writer as you are now?
Why not both?
Why not? Fuck it. Get that money. But, all right, on to AI. So, it's kind of in conjunction with the Writers Guild and the one went out. Never mind, we're back. Bruh, how the fuck I'm gonna get the arm and the microphone still goes out? That's how you know we broke a shit. Need another fucking microphone. Donate to the Two Tone Podcast by hitting that linktree.com/JAK Productions. There's a thing down there, feeling generous, you know, Cash App, Venmo, what you do. If you can't figure it out, email me at, I'm not gonna tell you my email, actually. Leave a comment, we'll figure out how to get it. What the fuck was we talking about?
AI.
All right. So it's kind of in conjunction with the writer's strike and the actors guild joining them. I feel like if it comes to the point where the writer's strike and the actors guild, you know, they're like, well, we're not giving y'all no more money. Fuck y'all and all your bullshit. I feel like there could be a future where like AI could make movies. Have you ever...
That'd be a shitty future.
Have you ever... Do you pay much attention to AI in general?
Not really.
Me neither, honestly. I don't read up on it too much.
I mean, I've started to like get into ChatGPT.
ChatGPT.
I've been starting to get into it because Evan.
ChatGPT is really cool. I'm
with the business idea that I had.
Oh yeah, how'd that meeting with him go the other day?
That's pretty good. Pretty fun.
Was it pretty informative as you hoped it would be?
Yeah.
That's good. I might say he's pretty helpful when if you need something that he knows about. But with ChatGPT and all that stuff, I feel like even with using ChatGPT and stuff, you've seen that it can give you kind of like a rough scaffolding for a movie idea, you know?
Yeah, which is freaking crazy.
I think that's part of like
because like I interrupted you. What were you gonna say?
I think that's like part of why the Writers Guild is on strike, if I'm correct, right?
Yeah,
that they're using AI to come up with like base ideas, so they don't have to use writers and stuff like that. Just kind of have the writers be a liaison for the story kind of deal.
Yeah. But when you first showed me ChatGPT, that shit was crazy. I asked it to write me a whole short story, and that short, like some of the short stories that they wrote, or the short film scripts that they wrote, were actually pretty decent.
I had to say, it is really fucking interesting to see like the evolution of AI, not only in ChatGPT and stuff, but like now I'm seeing videos that are like fully AI. Or like artificially generated.
Yeah.
And they look really fucking believable, you know. I think we talked about on the podcast before how like people are using AI like photo bots to make like OnlyFans accounts and shit.
Yeah.
That shit's fucked up. And I can only imagine that it's only in a, what's the fucking phrase I'm looking for?
Get worse.
It's only a matter of time until AI kind of takes over the movie industry, in my opinion, and the entertainment in general, really, you know?
In music in general, or like in any art form in general, it's going to take over.
I can totally see it happening, honestly.
Like even in music.
Well, I don't really know, because I don't know.
Think about it, because they got like holograms now.
Well, yeah, but
you don't need to be there to do concerts.
I mean, the holograms are like of people, though, you know. So, like, it's a hologram of Tupac or a hologram of,
I know, but you're not
Whitney Houston like, or whatever.
You could go get scanned for a hologram and then just be like, "Oh, well, I got a concert coming up," blah blah blah, and then just have your hologram play the concert instead of you.
But, I mean, then you still get the money, you know. It's not like necessarily. Well, I don't know. Yeah, okay, that kind of takes a.
Also, like writing.
Kind of takes a weird turn, you know.
Also, writing music.
Yeah. I don't know. I might say I really haven't dived, like.
Because didn't ChatGPT give you, like, chords and shit when you asked it to write a song?
I don't honestly remember exactly what it did, but I remember what you're talking about. I went into it and I was like, write me a little melody for a song or whatever, you know. I don't remember exactly what it gave me. I would imagine it would be, like, it's called Tabs. And it's just like a diagram of the strings and what fret to play on the strings. But I don't remember exactly what it had given me, but I couldn't really tell you one way or the other if it's capable or if it knows enough about like music formatting to like write a melody or like write, you know, like on a stanza.
Like we were talking about this the other day at work. The reason that the actors joined the strike was because they were the businesses I heard were like scanning in actors and stuff. So they'd put them in like post through VFX instead of like actually being there.
Like kind of how they do for animation when they put like the balls on them.
Yeah.
They do that, but like for their...
But like for their whole body.
Yeah, for like the topography of their face.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could see where that would be not good.
Because then they could just save it to the computer and then just have just use that instead of the actors.
Yeah, I don't think that would be beneficial for the actors in any way.
Yeah.
I have heard of I don't remember exactly who it was. I want to say it was Bruce Willis, but there was somebody that like sold their image and likeness so that they could be in they could be in more movies and stuff. They have some disorder or condition. I don't remember exactly what it was or who it was, honestly, but I remember some like A-list actor had sold their image and likeness so that they could use AI and stuff like that. It's interesting to see like the divide between who wants to do that, you know? Interesting stuff to think about.
I kind of feel like AI is gonna be terrible. Like when it takes over like the world and everybody's using it, it's gonna be rich people and poor people and that's it.
Oh yeah,
no, it's gonna middle class, nothing.
It's gonna be the death of imagination for certain.
Definitely.
It'll be very interesting to see where AI goes in the future.
Just imagine us like in our 80s and like everything's futuristic and they're playing this podcast on a big screen somewhere.
Like, look what I found in the archives, Grandpa. Like, oh, back in my day, we used to do podcasts. It's like, how do you watch them? With headphones. And they're like, what's that? You know, they just got fucking chips in their brain. They can just hear the podcast inside their head, you know?
Yeah.
Just flying with a jetpack to school type shit. It will definitely be interesting to see where all this AI shit goes. All right, let's get into one more topic, and then we can cut the podcast after one more. We kind of went over the writers' strike and the actors' guild combining.
Yeah.
Talked about AI.
So really, Rise of Indie Movies or Beetlejuice?
What you want to talk about? You want to talk about Beetlejuice or you want to talk about mainstream actors going into indie movies?
Mainstream actors, I guess.
Okay.
More beneficial for the audience that we have.
Okay.
To know this stuff.
So, have you seen any actors that have kind of vowed to transition into more underground production companies, rather?
Ever since the Actors Guild joined and stuff,
mm-hmm.
to the protests, I've been seeing all over the place that a lot of them are thinking about just doing indie films because they don't have a problem with indie films like they do with like the big companies and stuff.
So is the Actors Guild thing more of just like trying to get paid at like a fair wage, or is it kind of like that's pretty much the reason you go on strike, huh?
What?
I said I guess that's pretty much the reason you go on strike, huh, for better wages and stuff.
Yeah, I think that's a little bit of it. It's just better pay, but actually I don't know, because actors are getting paid pretty well, but I think they're just joining because they support the cause of the Writers Guild and how the writers should get treated and stuff by the companies.
I'm about to say, before the writers strike like came to fruition, I really didn't have any that should be the story of this fucking podcast, or the name of this podcast called What's the Word. Or what's the damn thing? The thing with the damn idea. God damn it! What was he talking about?
The Writers Guild. And how you didn't have, then you stopped. You didn't have any idea. You didn't have knowledge.
I couldn't tell you. I really couldn't tell you. Oh, Lord.
I'm guessing you were going to say that you didn't have any idea that it was a problem.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I didn't have any idea that, like, that there even was, like, you know, a union of writers in the community, you know. I didn't really know that it was a problem, that that writers didn't really get paid. I'm not really, like, in that community, you know. I don't really pay too much attention to what goes on in the movie industry.
Yeah. But I remember, like, a couple of days ago, you saying that you didn't really care about it happening.
Well, I mean, like
these, like, devil's advocate type of thoughts. Jalen's microphone's out, by the way. But yeah, I just feel like the Writers Guild, or the writers in general, are getting fucked over, but that's just what I think.
What was you saying just a second ago?
You were giving me devil's advocate ideas about...
Oh yeah, I'm about to say, I always love playing devil's advocate. That's just the person that I am. But... I can totally see where the writers are coming from, you know, in regards to the AI coming up with, like, the main idea of the script.
There's this head of the company somewhere. I think it was Warner Brothers or something.
Mm-hmm.
One of the big names in Hollywood, and he said. I don't care about the writers. Let's just fuck them over and let them lose their apartments and their housing and stuff and just wait it out.
Goddamn.
But yeah.
This is a little aggressive.
Like, he doesn't care about any writers not working or anything.
That's a little aggro, bro. You gotta pay the writers. I almost just quit this podcast because my microphone went out again, and then I touched it and it worked again. So y'all are lucky. But yeah, you gotta pay the writers, man. Like, yeah, they're the reason that you're directing or whatever, you know. They're the reason that your production company has a name.
Like, even the directors will sometimes come up with the story, but the writers are the ones that put it out.
Right,
they're the ones that are like, so how is this going to work? And then they just write out the whole script.
Right. Like, I feel like most of the time directors are the kind of people that come up with, like, the main idea of the movie. And then they hire writers to kind of put in, like, the minutia of the story that goes along with it, you know.
Or they'll, like, they'll write some of it down. Like, the directors will write, like, what they, like, they'll write, like, one or two pages, and then they'll be like, all right, you can finish this, and give it to the writers to finish.
Right, just kind of, like, put the bows on it, you know?
Yeah.
But, yeah.
But as an indie filmmaker, you need to do all of it, type shit.
Most definitely. But I could see where like, more mainstream actors would kind of lean towards doing indie productions and just kind of doing it for the love of the movie, you know?
Yeah,
being like a big name actor, there's not really much money in an indie kind of movie, you know, just like straight up from the production, you know.
Just imagine like Mark Ruffalo or like fucking Tom Cruise or like any of these like A-list actors.
Just like Robert Downey Jr. in some like B movie.
Going down to the
indie films. That would be fucking funny as shit.
Like, I remember back in my day when I started out as an actor, I had to do this shit all the time.
They're in some, like, set in North Dakota, and they're like,
it's like
that
two
was
people
Iron
running.
Man.
It's like two people running the camera. Or one's running the camera, and, like, one's the director of the film. It's
and they got to... They gotta run the camera when they're not on the scene.
Yeah.
That'd be fucking funny as shit.
Like, you know this.
I don't know nothing.
When we did our first, when I did my first film, or short,
even the night shift at youtube.com, or youtube.com/classhashfilms.
It's pretty short. But, like, you had to sometimes run the camera.
Oh, yeah. I might say I was running the camera, doing the lights.
But you
telling people to be like, all right, say it. And when Gaudium Leviosa, not Leviosa, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was doing everything, you know.
But, like, that was actually pretty helpful because, like, I could, like, stand behind and be like, all right, this is what we're doing type shit. Is it back on? All right. Jones, microphone, one out, one more time. All right. This has been the Two Tone Podcast. My name is Theo Kale. That is Jalen Kale over there. And his microphone went out, so he can't.
My mic.
So,
oh, I'm back. Oh, fuck you, back. TT. I'm doing the outro.
We need to get new microphones. We're on a broke ass budget over here. All right, so we. So Jalen's microphone went out again. But, so, we're on a broke-ass budget if you want to help out anyway in supporting this channel.
Figured out. Okay. Oh, shit. We're back. We're back.
Half Jalen.
I'm so sorry for everybody that's listening to this podcast. The production value is shit. We understand. We're trying to fucking get that money up. We're trying to make this a legitimate podcast. I want to say thank you so much to everybody that subscribed so far. If you're not subscribed and you make it this far into the podcast, thank you so much. Share it with a friend. Share it with your brother. Share it with your mother, your sister, your auntie, your grandma, your goldfish's brother. And hit that subscribe button. Hit that like. Hit leave a comment. You know, if you want to tell us this podcast was shit, leave the comment. I don't give a fuck. TT, you got any controversial topics to leave them off with before my microphone cuts out again?
Everybody deserves a chance
in
life at something.
Oh, shit. The quote of the week. We didn't even do the fucking quote of the week. All right, so
leave
the quote,
them off with the quote of the week, Jalen.
I'm going to leave you off with the quote of the week, and then I'm going to leave you off with the bonus quote of the week. All right, so this is the quote of the week is already a doubleheader, so you're going to get three quotes of the week.
In one.
Should I do it with him? Should I hit him with three quotes of the week? I'm going to do it regardless. All right, so the first quote, they are both from the Sing Street movie. All right, so the first quote, rock and roll is a risk. You risk being ridiculed. This is like a very inspirational quote in my music career, you know. You come out, you start making music. I can't tell you how many times in high school, you know, people were like, oh, you make music, you know, da-da-da-da, it's shit, da-da-da, you know, just talking shit. But, you know, I'm going to make music whether you like it or not. So if you like it, thank you so much. If you don't, thank you for the hate. It keeps me going. Anyways, on to the second quote of the week. You can never do anything by half. Do you understand that? Okay, good. And the third quote of the week is...
There's some people out there that don't understand that, though.
Let me switch the camera so
you know who I'm talking about.
Okay.
Type shit, you know.
All right, and then third quote of the week. I used to be a fucking jet engine.